Welcome back. I am Geert de Koning, University of Leuven and Energyville, and in this web lecture, we're going to talk about smart meters. How smart shall a smart meter be in a smart grid? Which type of ICT infrastructure, communication and information infrastructure, is needed for a smart meter to deploy? Which type and sizes of smart meters do exist? This is what I'm going to tell you during this web lecture. What is a smart meter to start with? Well, you all know the Ferraris meter, which is an analog meter for measuring your electricity consumption. It has multiple registers to register how much you're using in different time periods. But if you are producing electricity yourself, this Ferraris meter is turning backwards. So it doesn't make a difference between what you use from the grid and then produce back versus what you didn't use at all. If you have a digital meter, these different flows of energy towards and away from your home can be registered separately. So you're able to differentiate the usage of electricity from the grid versus what you produce yourself. A digital meter is also often combined with a communication module, that allows to read out the digital meter from a distance. So in fact, we have a more intelligent, smart meter. A smart meter with the digital information processing locally and the communication remotely. From that perspective, the smart meter can be a cornerstone for the smart grid because it is the endpoint at the home of the end user from the electricity infrastructure. However, there exist different types of smart meters. And if we look to the European policies, and the European policy level, as you see in these directives, Europe has put forward a number of requirements on the meters. Individual meters that should be able to reflect the actual consumer consumption of electricity and provide that information in real time. It's not something which is possible with a classic analog meter unless you're sleeping in front of your analog meter, then only you have the real-time information. Additionally, in the other directives, Europe puts forward that the member states should implement an intelligent metering system that allows active participation of the user. That is also a drive towards a smart meter away from the analog classic Ferraris meter. However, which type of intelligent meter is implemented, that differs quite a lot from one member state to the other. Let us make a kind of taxonomy, which type of smart meters do exist, from the more dummy ones to the more advanced intelligent ones. The most simple smart meter is the one that allows for automated meter reading. Automated meter reading means that remotely the measurement registers can be read out. You do not have to go to the meter physically in order to read the data. It can be read out by radio frequent communication from the street side, a car passing by, for instance, or there could be a kind of permanent connection via a communication network. That's the most simple type of dummy smart meter. If you add to the automated meter reading the possibility to send some simple control messages, like shutting down a customer or reconnecting it, him or her, or dimming the usage of electricity, then we talk about automatic meter management. Some simple control possibilities are there besides the monitoring of the electricity consumption and production. But if we really want a smart meter that can play a full role in a smart grid, implying also usage in demand response applications, we need to add much more control possibilities. In my opinion, only this latter type of smart meters deserve the name to be smart, and the other ones are just advanced digital meters. Which type of parameters are typically monitored and which type of control signals are sent out in such a more advanced smart meter? For sure, it needs to monitor, to measure how much power and energy you are consuming, both in kilowatts or watts, as well as in kilowatt hours. And this for the direction from the grid towards the home, as well as from what you produce in the home towards the grid. Besides active power and energy, also reactive power and energy needs to be measured. because a good power factor is important for dimensioning the grid at a particular level without over-dimensioning it. Besides the power consumption, also the peak power needs to be monitored, because a grid is dimensioned for the worst case, for the peak power usage. We are able to register whether we have some problems with the electricity, so the power quality data needs to be registered, over voltages, under voltages, and so on. And all of this periodically, could be every 15 minutes, or every day, or every week, every month, and so on. Besides these quantities to be monitored, also control functionality can be added. Control functionality, disconnecting customers, reconnecting customers, reducing the power connection from 3 kilowatts, for instance, back to 1 kilowatt at most, in order for someone to have some pressure to pay a bill, for instance, in order to implement budget meters. A third option for monitoring and control functionalities is to include the possibility to remotely modify the tariffs. So instead of just having 1 or 2 tariff periods per day, you could implement a system where there's an hourly varying tariff and the end user could see how much he or she has to pay during each tariff period. The smart meter hence needs to support this type of advanced tariffing systems. Additionally, if we need to add new functionality to the smart meter, we should be able to remotely upgrade the firmware of the smart meter. And if you want to integrate it in a kind of deployment of a smart grid at home, then it's good that the smart meter can send information forward to other controllers or home gateways. So we need a taxonomy for the different types of additional functionalities for the smart meters. And this has been put forward by SEN, SENELEC, and ECTSI, which are 3 standardization organizations. From the more dummy to the more advanced type of smart meters, from level F1 to level F6. At level F1, we just start with the remote reading out of meteorological registers and providing the information to the market actors. If you add to that not only one-way, but 2-way communication, then you're able to send control signals towards the meter. At level 3, you're supporting the advanced tariffing schemes. For additional functionality number 4, you're able to control, to some extent, the enabling and disabling of electricity customers. If you're able to export the meteorological data from your smart meter to a display device for the customer to be aware of his or her electricity consumption, we talk about additional functionality level 5. And at level 6, we provide information to a gateway that allows it to further spread the information in home for different control purposes. So this extra type of functionality allows the implementation of a smart grid at home via a gateway that sends a control signal to appliances and allows, for instance, to charge an electric vehicle when there is solar energy provided from a photovoltaic installation. And this information can be sent from one to the other. We call these additional functionalities because the basic functionality of registering how much electricity you consume is always included. These additional functionalities provide additional levels of smartness for the smart meter. So we have 6 levels of additional functionality, plus an extra level for more advanced control applications. Where do we deploy which type of smart meter? Does every household need the most advanced type of smart meter with all the additional functionalities? Or can we go for a cheap solution with only the remote meter reading? Well, it depends on what the objectives of the overall smart grid deployment and smart metering deployment are. If you have just the functionalities at level F1, you are not really supporting a smart grid. You cannot send any control information to the homes, you are just metering in remotely the measurement registers. If you want to deploy your bidirectional communication, then you need to take into account all the cybersecurity considerations. There's a separate web lecture on that. If you are operating your smart meter in a context where there are different market participants with different tariff structures, then it surely makes sense to add level F3 of additional functionality, because then you're able to take the market context into account and to change in different tariff periods to different time usages. Level 4 of additional functionalities is about disconnection of remote customers, for instance, as well as reconnection. We need to take into account that if a customer is not paying the bill anymore, it makes no sense to disconnect him completely. Many countries put some social limits that a limited amount of electricity should also always be applied to the customer. In this context, you need to support additional functionality at level 4. For the levels 5 and 6, there's the possibility to make the link to the home automation systems and hence to deploy a smart grid at home. Many customers, especially the smaller households, do not have sufficient flexibility that imply that level 5 and 6 is useful for them. However, the large customers can benefit really from more advanced demand response applications and use electricity, for instance, for charging electric vehicle or for heating up water in an electric boiler, at the moment that the electricity price is low or at the moment that they are producing electricity from a photovoltaic installation. What we see in the different states of Europe, what we see in the different countries in the world, is that a deployment of a smart metering system is quite different from one country to the other. Some only stay at the level of F1, F2 remote meter reading, while others go much further towards full control possibilities. SEN, Senelec and ETSI, which are the standardization organizations, have also standardized the architecture in which such a smart meter needs to be deployed. It specifies the different interfaces towards the head-end systems via a wide area network connection. It specifies the interfaces between the different homes, between the different premises, via a neighborhood network connection, as well as it's specifying the interfaces within a home, where you see a local network between the appliances and the smart meter, for instance. For each of these networks, we could use different information and communication technology, or we could share functionality over multiple networks. So which type of information and communication infrastructure is useful for this context? Well, there exist many types of communication means. We can go for wired solutions like cable TV or phone line, XDSL solutions. We can go for wireless solutions like mobile telephony or Wi-Fi connections. We can use the power line as a communication infrastructure, or any combination of those. What we want as additional levels of functionality determines the requirements with respect to the bandwidth, the latency, the reliability of those information and communication infrastructure. Hence, determining the level of smart meter support from F1 to F6 also implies that you have to make a decision which information and communication infrastructure you are going to use. If you have only the limited additional set of functionalities, like periodic meter reading from a distance, then it doesn't matter which type of communication means you are choosing, because all of those communication means are supporting the minimal advanced meter requirements. However, if you do have to send a lot of data, you certainly need a broadband connection that would favor broadband-based solutions, mobile telephony, cable TV-based, XDSL-based. Or if you have to support real-time applications, like sending control signals over the grid and the users have to react immediately, then you need to support broadcasting. And broadcasting, like which is supported by powerline carrier or wireless solutions. Besides those technical solutions, of course, also non-technical aspects do play a role. The costs, obviously, as well as who is owning the communication infrastructure? If they are different people independent from the system operators, electricity system operators, for instance, telecom operators, then you are in a different situation than when someone is owning the entire infrastructure his or her on his own. So in general, you choose a certain level of additional functionality for the deployment of smart meters, from less to more advanced smart meters. That implies also the communication and information infrastructure to be deployed. And there you have to meet all the requirements from real-time, broadband, dependability, perspective, and so on. You do not only have to take a look at the current requirements for deploying a smart meter, you also have to look at future requirements. If we really want to deploy a full smart grid in the future and having an implementation of smart grid functionality down to the level of the homes that participate, that have active customers, then you need a more advanced type of smart meter and the corresponding communication and information infrastructure. This concludes our web lecture on smart meters. I have given you an insight which type of additional functionalities make a meter, an intelligent metering system, more smart or less smart, and I talked about which type of communication information infrastructure is needed for that.